Well, yeah, let's celebrate that again. Thank you all so much for investing and continuing to invest and being such a generous body. Speaking of that, as those who have been designated to take the offering, if you guys will come forward, I want to draw your attention to at least three announcements. One that has to do with this Sunday, one that has to do with next Sunday, and one that has to do with the Sunday after next. This Sunday, today, right after the service, we've got a guest lunch. And so if you're a guest, if you're a Fellowship Memphis person that brought a guest, you come too. Go right after the service, grab your kids if you have any, and come go straight out the back, straight down the right, and you'll see a big guest lunch sign down that hallway. We'd love to take 15, 20 minutes, get to know your name, tell you a little bit about us, feed you lunch, and that's all on us. So nobody planned for that, but we planned for you, and so we've got lunch for you, and I hope you'll take advantage of that. Next Sunday, we've got an incredible fall festival afternoon for those in our fellowship student ministry, which is 5th through 12th, and their family and siblings. Now, that's going to take place starting at 4 o'clock, going through 8 o'clock. Got all kinds of foods, games, inflatables. I think there's even a movie being shown, and so dinner's going to be served. You can come to any or all of that. That's going to be at our Fellowship Germantown campus, which is at St. George's Elementary, but it's for our entire church, those involved with Fellowship Student Ministry, family, and siblings. And so all of that is listed in your bulletin, but take advantage of that next Sunday afternoon. And then finally, 2 weeks from today, Lord willing, will be our 13th anniversary as a church, and we're going to attempt to gather everybody together at the Levitt Shell for one service. And so we are monitoring the weather for that, as we always do. I think I've got a slide. All right, this was yesterday on my phone. And if you'll look at Tuesday, November 1st, we're aiming for this November 6th. And currently, we've got about 4 or 5 days of no rain. And so we need that to stay the same, to have a great time on a Sunday morning in an outdoor service. And so we'll have alternative plans. We'll continue to watch the weather. But prepare yourself, and you'll get more details for a all-together church service Sunday morning at the Levitt Shell, and we'll have a time for that and more details in the weeks to come. One other thing I want to encourage you, we're going to do a little more, draw a little more attention to this over the next few weeks. Our Fellowship Memphis app is really helpful. It's got all kinds of past sermons, current sermons, stories that you read in the bulletin are on there. But there's a notification feature that we're going to start taking advantage of. And so it will inform you of things like, hey, weather's looking good, or we just posted this, or even the day of. There's a backup on Walnut Grove, best to take Poplar to get to the Levitt Shell, and it pops immediately. Or as we turn into fall turns into winter here in a few months, if we ever have to cancel a service because of inclement weather, it's easiest to notify you all that way. So feel free, while during the sermon today, right now, later, download that app. I think it defaults to notification on. If you've got the app and you want that kind of information, turn it on, and we're going to be pushing more information through our app. All right, we're in Galatians 3. We've been here all fall. Galatians 3, chapter 1 is where we're going to start today. As a on-ramp to that, I want to remind you, Paul wrote this letter to the Galatians. He is, the first two chapters are a personal defense, that the gospel he preached is a pure gospel and affirmed by the early church and Peter and James and John and the early church leaders, that he is going to war with something in this church in Galatia called Judaizers, who are Jews who claim Jesus is the Messiah. They claim that Jesus is the Messiah, but that the Gentiles that enter the church have to take on Jewish customs. It's not just believing that Jesus was Messiah. They also want to maintain circumcision and certain festivals and certain religious cultural things unique to them as a Jewish people. And so Paul goes ballistic, and it says in chapter 1, he's astonished that this church would even consider Christ plus anything for salvation. And so he is rebuking them in a sense. He's calling them back to the purity of the gospel. In chapter 2, we had an encounter, Paul with Peter, and Peter had begun eating with Gentiles. Peter had struggled as a Jew with Gentiles coming into the church early in the book of Acts. And God gave him a dream, and he showed him all these Gentile foods that he should be enjoying. And so he starts walking into that inclusive gospel community with that this newfound church that's going to contain Jews and Gentiles. And yet some of his Judaizer friends, some of his Jewish friends come to him and challenge him on that. They are calling him to become a Judaizer, to distance himself from the Gentiles. And so Paul calls that out and says, that racist heart, that heart that wants to revert to people just like you, that's not living consistent with the gospel. And so we taught on that and shared about that in chapter 2, the last 2 weeks. So if you want to catch up on some of our thoughts on the gospel and race in Galatians 2, that's where I would send you the last 2 weeks of sermons. Well, today it moves from a personal defense of chapter 1 and 2, Paul personally defending himself and his message, to a really beautiful theological defense. And so I want to read the first 4 or 5 chapters here. O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. Let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? Did you suffer so many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supplied the Spirit to you and work miracles among you, does he do that by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? And so here you see Paul with these rhetorical questions, calling them out of works back into faith alone. He says, oh, foolish Galatians, somebody's tricking you. Again, chapter 1, I'm astonished that you would abandon the purity of the gospel. So chapter 1 and chapter the beginnings of chapter 3 here have to do with this theological term called justification. Justification is my being made right because of the finished work of Jesus, period. My belief that Jesus Christ, his life he lived, satisfied God, his death he died, satisfied God's wrath and sin, and his resurrection, defeating Satan, sin, and death, that I can have life in him eternally, and I'm justified. Now, it's interesting, next week, Paul's going to get into some really relational language when it comes to the gospel, especially around the term adoption, which I've got a personal passion for. That idea of God's adopting us in his family. Today, he's using real legal language and accounting terms. So this week, think accountant and legal when you think about the ramifications of the gospel. Next week, it'll be beautiful and redemptive and personal and familial when we get into adoption. But so he is fighting for justification by faith alone, through grace, by grace alone and Christ alone, through faith alone. That's what he's fighting for. And he's saying, someone's tricked you. You alone, it was before your eyes that Jesus Christ, verse 1, was publicly portrayed as crucified. That you've come to see. The Spirit's led you to have your eyes opened and your ears unplugged to see the beauty and the sufficiency of Christ. And so notice what's primary here. Notice what the essence of the gospel is for Paul. And it's important that we don't miss this. The essence of the gospel for Paul is Christ crucified. That's what he calls them to. He doesn't call them to a new set of behavior or some kind of moralism or some kind of lifestyle or some kind of church culture. Now, we're performers at heart, right? We tend to want to earn our way into things. But notice that Paul's primacy is on Christ crucified. That when you get down to the nuts and bolts of justification, you're getting down to the Christ crucified, and you cut away all the fat, and you get right to it. And that's what Paul is arguing here. And he asks these questions. Let me ask you this. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing faith? And so you constantly see these two going back and forth. And he's made an argument to the Ephesians. Look at this slide with me here on Ephesians, where he says this in Ephesians 2. It says, for grace you were saved through faith. And it is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. And so this is how he wrote the same thing to the Ephesians. Grace has saved you through faith. Then he goes on to say, yes, stay right there for a second. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God. And I would argue the way it's written, if you could see it in its original language, it's not just the grace, the saving, and the faith. All that's a gift of God. God gave you, offers us grace, gives us the faith to believe in Christ crucified. And so it's God acting upon us, again, to open our eyes, to open our ears, to see the beauty and sufficiency of the crucified Christ. And so that's what it means to become a Christian. It's to believe in that, to be justified. It's not cleaning yourself up. It's not making yourself better. It's not following some list of commandments. It's believing in the finished work of another. That's what justifies us before God. Then he goes on, didn't just save us. He saved us because we're his workmanship. The word there is literally the word pomeo, where we get the word poetry, that we are his pieces of art. Another sermon for another day. Created in Christ Jesus for good works. So he doesn't just save us. to secure us a spot in heaven and reconcile us to God. He saves us for good works, which he has prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them, that he's got purpose and meaning for our life here. I've said before in a rather grotesque way, when we baptize you, we don't just hold you under, right, and send you on to heaven. Like, you're raised to walk in a newness of life into these preordained by God works that he's created, and it's really specific here for you and for me. There are things he has us to do and that we shall do. And then he says, are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit? Verse 3, are you now being perfected by the flesh? So you Galatians, having believed in Jesus, having been justified by grace alone through Christ alone, here's the phrase, are you now being perfected by the flesh? And I would argue this is going to be a lot of our struggles in this room. Yeah, we believe Jesus saved me. I believe in Jesus. I call myself a Christian. I call myself a Christ follower. I'm fine with that phrase. I believe in Christ alone through faith alone, that what he did on that cross satisfied God. But then are you also then turning to your flesh to perfect you? Now, again, the theological term for this is sanctification. It's a little small. Some of you probably won't see this in the back, but it's sanctification. And sanctification is this idea of spiritual growth. And I'll go ahead and put our third one up here. It's the idea of glorification. So justification is my legal right standing before God on the finished work of Jesus. Sanctification, then, is having been justified, is spiritual growth. It is becoming and walking in Christ's holiness. It is, it's three things at least. It's positional. So justification can't be taken away, so I am sanctified. It's positional. It's progressive, that you and I are going to take two steps forward and nine steps back and stumble and bumble and have victory over this one day and failure the next day, that it's progressive, all right? It'll be perfect, but it's perfect one day in glorification. That this is when God, you die, or Jesus comes back to get us, we are with him. Jesus said to the thief on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. And so that's when we will be glorified. Now, in glorification, there are no more tears. There is no more sin. There's no Satan, no sin, no flesh. See, that's the trifecta working against you and I every second of every day. Our flesh, enticed by the things of this world, fueled by Satan, his demons, their causes and effects. We're fallen people in a fallen world, yet God's done a work in our life. And so what Paul's saying to the Galatians here is, you who believed, are you now trying to be perfected by your flesh? And this is what many of us do. Tragically, it's what many of us were taught to do. Like, be thankful for your justification, but now, buddy, you better pull up your bootstraps and get to work. Like, you got to get up earlier. You got to muster willpower. You got to discipline yourself. You got to make this happen. And if we're not careful, rather than trusting the gospel to grow us, which is good gospel biblical growth, we think we have to own our sanctification. Just like he said here, that, hey, are you now being perfected by your flesh? Do you think your flesh can make you perfect in this world? I would argue no. I would argue most of us have no problem with the idea that God initiated toward us and opened our eyes and opened our ears that we might be justified and see the beauty of Jesus. I bet very few of us are struggling with making plans for heaven. I doubt you've looked on Zillow and tried to find a house and tried to figure out where it is and what kind of job you're going to have in heaven. And I don't think you're worrying about meals. I don't think anybody's buying future heaven life insurance. I think you're pretty okay allowing God to take care of you after you die or when he returns. All right? But this one, man, we get so in the way. We were just like, God did it. God's going to do it. This is all me. I got to work and will. And then this gets really complex. Stay with me here. If we're not really sure that our salvation is secured in the finished work of Jesus, we use our sanctification for our justification. See, we think our standing before God this morning and living out this day is a means to please him. The truth is, we're infinitely pleased by the eternal king of the universe because of the finished work with Jesus, okay? We are infinitely pleasing to him because of Jesus. And when we get that, then this becomes a, a chance to be disciplined, to read our Bible, to pray, to fast, to do the one another verses, to do everything your New Testament says, but you're doing that from approval, not for approval. And that changes everything. You're doing that from approval. Your salvation is off the table. That's been secured. So you're freed to struggle. You're free to confess sin. You're free to live in this tension of being a saint and a sinner. Like, I'm positionally saint and sinner. I'm positionally saved for all of eternity, and I have a flesh that sins. Martin Luther used a Latin term, and I'll probably butcher it, but here's the way he came up with it. Some of you took Latin. Harlan, Kentucky Independent School District didn't offer Latin. So it was simul justus et peccator, simultaneously saint and sinner. So simultaneously, that's how he pitched this view of sanctification, of gospel growth, that at the very same time, I am far worse off than I could ever admit and far more infinitely loved than I could ever know. At the same time. So what does gospel growth look like? We'll get to that in just a second. It says, do you suffer, verse 4, many things in vain, if indeed it was in vain? Does he who supply the Spirit to you and work miracles among you do so by the works of the law or by hearing with faith? And so again, he's pointing to that. That he's reminding us we've been filled with the Spirit. Like yes, we have a flesh within us, but we also have this Holy Spirit within us, that there's this war within us until Jesus comes back or we're glorified. And so that's the war we're called into. And then he says, look, just as Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. So now Paul goes way back to Genesis 15. You may or may not be familiar with this story, but God called a guy named Abram when he was in Genesis 12, to leave Ur, which was the epicenter of its day. Ur is credited with having the first city with indoor plumbing. It would have been the place to be, the up-and-coming place to get a job. He left family, and God, Hebrews tells us, called Abram to leave, not knowing where he was going. And you can imagine how that leaving might have been in that day, where there's no flights back, right? There's no texting to keep up with each other. There's no Facebook. Like, to leave is to say, see you for the rest of this life. And so God, and without knowing where he was going, so he had to trust God to take him on this journey. And God promised he'd make him land, seed, and blessing. He'd give him this land, this promised land, that he would have descendants more than the stars in the sky or the sand on the beach, and that from him would come Messiah. The seed would be a blessing to the world. And so Abram starts out following God, and he just like us, he takes two steps forward, four steps back, lies about his sister, creates an altar for God, lies about her again, tries to manipulate things, brings Lot with him, creates all these plan Bs for God. And so if you were to chart out Abraham's spiritual life after leaving Ur, it looks like yours and mine. You know what I'm saying? It is up and down. And so he feels like he's disappointed God. And so God creates this little ceremony for him, and he has Abram go get all these animals, cut them in half, and then God does this unilateral walk through those animals where they're shed blood, puts Abraham to sleep, and then he reaffirms the promise to him. He says, I'm going to make you a man of a great nation. Now, the other problem I forgot to tell you is this couple is infertile. They can't have a baby, and God keeps putting pressure on him to create more descendants than the stars in the sky and the sand on the beach. And yet here he is now, 70-year-old, 80-year-old, 90-year-old, 100-year-old man at this moment, and with a 90-year-old wife who's never been able to have kids. And God keeps coming to him about these descendants. And so God reaffirms that part of it. It says at the beginning, look at this in Genesis 15. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram. Most oft-quoted phrase in your Bible is fear not. We're all terrified. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, oh Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless. Is it the heir of my house, Eliezer? Again, he's always offering up like we do these plan Bs. And Abram said, behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be my heir. And look what God says. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. The man shall not be your heir. You shall have your very own son. And he brought him outside, and he told him to look toward heaven, number the stars, if you're able to number them. Then he said to them, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord, and he counted it. Some of your Bible says he reckoned it to him as righteousness. And so leave that up for a second. It's like, this is why Paul goes back to Abraham. This is salvific. Like this acorn, the fact that righteousness is something counted to us, righteousness is something credited to us, that acorn will become an oak called Romans or an oak called Galatians. Like that idea, that phrase in Genesis 15, that righteousness is not something you and I earn, righteousness is something reckoned to us, credited to us, created somewhere else and deposited in our account. That's the idea of reckoning, of counting. That's how righteousness comes. And so that is a massive, that has massive implications for all of New Testament theology and the point he's making today. And how brilliant it was for Paul, who's arguing against these Judaizers who are trying to add to a earned righteousness by circumcision, to go back to the father of Judaism, Abraham, and go, even Abraham wasn't saved by circumcision or rituals. Abraham was saved by a righteousness credited to him. And Abraham believed God for a future promise that he was coming through. When did I graduate college? 1991. It's my graduation day. Somehow talked everybody into skipping the baccalaureate, so we just got into the graduation. I remember just boring graduation speech. Finally, we walked across the deal up here, got handed, you know, the diploma and its little fold-over deal. Came off, a few people yelled, went outside. My family gathered. They'd all come in. They wanted a family picture. I found a friend, you know, who could take the picture for us. I think we actually had cameras back then. For those of you under 30, there's like these things that take pictures. Your phone does now. But it's like a camera. And I remember posing, and you got mom, dad, sister, brother, aunt, uncle, and I was kind of holding the cover like that. And he was like, man, open it so we can take the picture. And I opened it, opened my diploma. And I looked down, and I went white. A diploma withheld because of $695 due in parking tickets. And there he was. I didn't have any money. I didn't have $695. So I have to kind of show it to my dad. You know, we do our little thing, ask everybody to stay here. And the business office is right next to the chapel. So we take the walk of shame, man, all the way over. I see a couple other sons and dads. We go in there. He pulls out a checkbook, okay? It's his account. His checkbook, he's furious. He writes $695, but listen, that check of his gets credited to John Bryson's account. I didn't earn it. I didn't deserve it. That's not mine. That was someone else's money. Got credited my account. We slid the check across. They slid a diploma across. We went back outside. I put the diploma in, you know, and we posed for a picture. That's the idea, that righteousness credited to you. It's not yours. You didn't earn it, but yet it shows up in your account, and it is perfectly sufficient. Paul goes back to Abraham to argue this point. Abraham believed God. Now, we won't beat this horse to death, but go back to Galatians here. Just as Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. So a direct quote of Genesis 15 I just showed you. Now notice, it didn't say he believed in God or believed there was a God and it was credited to him as righteousness. This is very personal. This is very specific. Saving faith is specific. Saving faith is not generic. Oh, I believe there might be a God. I believe Jesus might have even been an inspired teacher or person or a faith leader. No, no, no. It says Abraham believed God, like he personally believed him that he was for a personal promise that he would provide for him a son in the future. And so this idea here is very specific, and it was credited him or reckoned him as righteousness. Again, something that came to him. He didn't clean himself up first. Verse 7, know that it is those of faith who are the sons of Abraham. And so it's not the Jewish people who are the sons of Abraham. It is the people of faith who are the sons of Abraham. And it's a Jewish guy writing this. That's fascinating. Another sermon for another day. And the scripture, verse 8, foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preach the gospel ahead of time to Abraham. So that's what God's... That's how Paul described Genesis 15, is God preaching the gospel to Abraham, saying, in it you shall all the nations be blessed, redeemed to bless others. which leads us to gospel growth. So what does gospel-centered sanctification look like? What is that? Well, there's one way it can look. It typically looks in a lot of churches, a lot of us from a lot of backgrounds. Let's put up, we do what we call shrink the cross. So it's got conversion on the top there, and kind of right where the two arrows come together is salvation. In the top line there is a growing awareness of God's holiness. And the bottom line there is a growing awareness of my flesh and my sin. And so as you and I theoretically begin to mature in our walk with Christ, our view of God and his perfection and our holiness gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's true. Like, you're like, oh my gosh, man, when I became a Christian, I didn't even realize how much I had offended God. And the more I read my Bible and the more I learn, the more I realize what an offensive, self-centered person I am and what a perfect, holy God that God is. And so that idea of God's holiness continues. And then there's also, at the same time, this growing awareness of my sin. Like, I see more and more and more of my sin. That I recognize that, man, it's just not what I do outside. It is what's going on inside. Like my motives and what I think and what I think about people and how I want to respond and what's going on in my heart. Jesus says, yeah, that counts too. So it's like external and internal. And so it's like, golly, I am far worse off than I would ever admit. Now, let's go back for a second to the shrinking cross. If we're not men and women of repentance, if we don't recognize that this is off the table and that we're free to be in the midst of gospel growth, we'll shrink the cross. And what that means is we pretend and perform. So if you were the two things, what above the cross I'd put pretend, below the cross I'd put perform. Like if we're not taught to be men and women of repentance and this whole thing's about grace and there's not a grace-centered, gospel-centered movement in your heart when it comes to your spiritual life, you'll spend a lot of time in pride and a lot of time in unbelievable insecurity. A lot of time trying to earn God's favor. When you feel pretty good about that this afternoon or today or last week or this weekend, we tend to swell up in pride. And when we blow it, not if but when, then we're devastated. Because if we think our sanctification rests on our performance, and worse, our sanctification determines our justification, and all that's based on performance, we're going to have be great at pretending and performing, great at pretending and performing, and we're going to have a really little cross, and we're not going to be able to worship Jesus much. Or if we came into this thing not really understanding, there was much to say. You know, we were one of the good kids. Wasn't much to say from us. We got a really little cross. We struggle to really worship Jesus, to be honest with you, because we don't think he saved us from much. But let me show you what gospel growth looks like. Yeah, the cross chart. Like, it's the same thing. There is a growing awareness of God's holiness, and there's a growing awareness of my sin and my flesh, and I admit both those things readily. But the cross keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger in my heart. You know, Jesus keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger in my heart because I'm becoming a man of repentance. And hopefully you're becoming men and women of repentance that sees God's standard in our behavior. And we're just quick to repent. So in this, there's a lot of repentance. There's a lot of being quick to be thankful for Jesus, to say, thank you, Jesus. You just see more and more of what Jesus has done for you. I like the way Paul describes this right here in the very first part of his ministry. He said, I'm the least of all apostles. 10 years later, he wrote a letter to the Ephesians, and he says, I'm the least of all God's people. Okay, I'm the least of the apostles. I'm the least of all God's people. And then at the end of his life, wrote a letter to Timothy, 1 Timothy 1. It says, I'm the worst of all sinners. So notice that trajectory. We're talking about Paul, who wrote 2/3 of our New Testament. His spiritual life took him deeper and deeper and deeper into his sin. I'm the worst of all these apostles. I feel shamed that I'm not as godly and holy as these other 11 guys. Whew, decade later, I've learned I'm not just the worst of them. Just get all Christians. I'm the worst of all Christians. This is Paul. 10, 15 years later, I'm the worst human on the planet. Like, I've lived with me long enough now to know it's unbelievable the thoughts I have and the things I say and the things I do. But what Paul understood was grace would allow him to go to the very depths of his sin, not lower God's standard, but just go, that gap between my sin and God's standard is Jesus, not my performance. So then he would worship Jesus. To God be the glory forever and ever. And that's what he's going crazy for over this church, messing with that. Like destroying the gospel, which is to create another gospel, and you can't create another gospel. That's what he's fighting for. And so good gospel growth is full of confession and repentance that I'm not so offended, like when I'm corrected or someone confronts me about something because I have a working recognition of my fallenness and not willing to compromise God's holiness, but I know Jesus has stepped in and stood in that gap. And so that's where he goes here. He says, so then those who are faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. So he just says there's two paths here. You can either trust and be a man, woman of faith, like Abraham's faith, or you can try to earn your own salvation. You can try to work the law. Now, that's a curse in a couple of ways. It's a curse theologically. We're born into sin. We sin as quickly as we can. We've offended a holy and perfect God. It's also a curse psychologically because, man, have you read the law? Like, you have to keep all of it. Anybody work their way through Leviticus? You know? I mean, it is a heavy burden. Often in evangelism opportunities, I've asked people how they know. If God were to, if they were to stand before God today and ask them how should they get into heaven, what would you tell them? And most folks would say some version of, I hope my good outweighs my bad. Or a couple times I've had people go, I've tried to keep the Ten Commandments. I said, fascinating. So if you attempt to keep the Ten Commandments, that's what you're banking your future eternal relationship with God on. Yes. I don't mean to be a smart aleck, but can you name me five or six of them? Don't kill, don't steal. Wait a second. That's what you're banking your salvation on? You can name me two of them? Like, we got a problem here. And there's not just the Ten Commandments. There's like 640 of them. And, man, you don't just have to keep them all. You have to keep them all perfectly, never having failed one of them. That's the curse of the law. That's the weight of the curse. So you can live one way trying to earn God's favor through keeping the law. Verse 10, cursed be everyone who doesn't abide by all things written in the book of the law. So that's what he's saying. You got to keep them all if you're trusting you for salvation. Now, verse 11, it's evident that no one is justified before God by the law. The righteous will live by faith. So that's what is salvific. You can't save yourself keeping the law, though your flesh wants to tell you that. You can only be justified before God by living by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Verse 13, Christ redeemed us. Praise God for that. From the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hanged on a tree, Deuteronomy 21. So we exchange our curse for his blessing. He took on our curse on that cross. He became a curse for us, took our sin and took the penalty of that curse away and offers to us salvation. Martin Luther calls that the great exchange. I exchange my sin, my filth, my curse for his blessing, his resurrection, his life before God. Anybody say amen to that? So, Father, thank you for Jesus, that it is in Christ Jesus that the blessing of Abraham may come to the Gentiles so that we might receive, Lord. What a passage, Jesus. Thank you for Paul and his brilliance and his legal language and his accounting and his linking all this to Abraham and his willingness to go to war for the gospel with the Galatians. And several thousand years later, it's a gift to us. In a lot of ways, the church in Galatia describes our own heart. So, Father, I pray for anyone in here that has never put their faith in the crucified Christ and the finished work of Jesus. Maybe they have thought about church or Christianity or Christ following being some set of moral code or religiosity. I pray today that their eyes would be open, their ears would be open to see the beauty and the sufficiency of Christ. Lord, for any of us in here that have stepped over that threshold of faith, but boy, sanctification is jumbled, and man, I'm trying to earn and please God's favor with my prayer life, my devotional life. I'm trying to willpower myself. Lord, I pray that they would recognize that your yoke is easy and your burden is light, and that they would turn to Jesus to not just save them, but grow them. And Father, we thank you that we have eternity secured, that we don't have to worry about glorification, that there'll be a day, one day, when we're with you forever. And no, there'll be no more tears. And so, Lord, may today be somebody's day of salvation. May these tables be a place we can come repent of our self-righteousness, Lord, our sin, and turn to you and find relief in the finished work of Jesus. We love you, Father. Spirit will play. You'll move in this room. In Christ's name, amen. Well, as we turn toward a time of reflection, the tables will be open. So here and in the back, You can come alone, come with your friends, come with your family. It's also a time of prayer. We'll have some elders, prayer teams, pastors here to pray with you in this as we reflect on Jesus' body broken for us and his blood shed on our behalf. And then we'll sing and pray some more, and we'll be done. So the tables are open.